doing something close to about 40 to 50,000 signatures a day, and this is going to go something like 200,000 signatures a day. It's a huge thing, but you know, when GST is rolled out in July, it is expected to go, you know, enormously high. So then I'll talk about one of these things. Another thing is, some of you have probably done PAN card application, you know, applying for PAN card. In let's say last 5-6 months, you probably would have actually done this online authentication and online digital signature using the same. So these are the two things which are well known, but then there are many other things. Like for example, performance appraisal of all government officers is actually carried out using e-sign. So there are many things which we are doing, but then e-sign will actually get into that. So I'll talk about some of those applications as well. So if you look at the Digital India, the vision is very, very small. Just 3 bullet items. Say, provide digital infrastructure as a utility. So it should be possible, and I'll expand each of these. Digital infrastructure should be available as a utility. So if I want to, for example, like water as a utility, electricity as a utility, digital infrastructure should be available as a utility. One should be able to get this whenever one wants it, whenever one needs it. The second thing is, governance and services on demand. Right? So 24/7 services, governance, information, all of that on demand. And the third one is digital empowerment of citizens, which is basically slightly overlapping with second one. Second one talks about the governance, third one actually talks about in general for the citizen. You know, so one can actually provide services over this infrastructure. So these are the effectively 3 different vision items, very simple vision items, and I'll expand each of this. So, and here, the bold items are the ones which are leading towards e-sign, so I just kept it on bold. So the vision is, for example, infrastructure as a utility for every citizen. Digital infrastructure as a utility. And in that, there are sub-bullet items saying what all we need to do. High-speed internet as a core utility is an important thing. And to that extent, there is a program called BharatNet, which is basically connecting optical fiber to every village. It has already gone several steps ahead in Telangana and Andhra. Lot of villages have already been put together. And it is actually going in several places like Odisha and other places. It is expected that in about 2 to 2.5 years' time, we would have something close to about 200,000 villages connected on optical fiber network. And optical fiber network with at least 48 ports. The speeds can be actually enormous. But then this is a digital infrastructure. Now this digital infrastructure is also coupled with the kind of services that can be done. So it is actually going to be effectively a model equivalent to spectrum. So spectrum sale happened. You know, people actually bid for spectrum. Similarly, people can actually go and bid for either the fiber itself or the bandwidth on the fiber. And some of the bandwidth will be reserved for government applications. So for example, if there is a cable TV network, cable TV can be actually relayed on optical fiber. If there is a mobile network, today a major issue is mobile connectivity. A mobile network can actually, and usually mobile network on the back end actually have a wired connectivity, optical fiber or whatever. And this infrastructure which has been installed by various companies a long time back is actually now, you know, towards a phasing out mode, right? I mean, it requires a major optical fiber replacement. Otherwise, the optical fiber quality, data rates are actually going to go down drastically. And therefore, this particular service can be used because this is going to be available right up to the village. In fact, one of the major criticisms of optical, of mobile network has been that it is not available in villages, right? But I think things have actually changed quite a lot. But the changes have happened not because the network is available at that place, but it is because the wireless network is available. Right? So people have actually put not many more transmitting towers and all that. It is a wireless network that is available. But then wireless network will always have an issue of bandwidth. You know, how many people will come onto that network? So wireless network is typically for last mile connectivity. Subsequently, long haul connectivity is actually provided by wired network, which is typically optical fiber. NKN is yet another example, which is an optical fiber, right? But then NKN also can piggyback on this, so that NKN expansion can happen. The second important part is also part of the digital infrastructure, which is cradle to grave digital identity, which is, you know, as Aadhaar, unique, lifelong, online authenticated. These are the three major parameters. It is unique, it is lifelong for a person, and it is online authenticated. Now, there have been a lot of questions and a lot of accusations that people have raised on this. But by and large, it has been very successful. Today, as we sit here, 1.12 million people have been issued Aadhaar identity. Right? With a population of 1.25 million, you know, it actually comes to almost close to 93-94% of the population already covered by Aadhaar. So therefore, this issue that people will not have Aadhaar is actually now not very relevant. Most of the people who actually don't have Aadhaar are kids, young kids, less than 1 year and so on and so forth. And they don't have it because they were not registered in the beginning. Now they are also being registered, where up to 5 years a kid can actually be registered with Aadhaar using parents' biometric. And then by 15 years of age, the biometric has to be updated. Now since this has been linked with the birth and death certification, it basically is meaning that today any kid who is born in this country, he automatically gets registered for Aadhaar. I mean, invariably, that is what is going to happen, except one or two such cases where the birth may not take place in hospital or somewhere, or the Aadhaar enrollment might not be available or something like that. By and large, 1.12 billion population on Aadhaar is a great achievement. Then, mobile phone and bank account, right? Mobile phone, again, 95 crore people actually have access to mobile phone, out of which about 50 crore, close to 47, 48 crore is actually smartphone penetration. Now, that's a very big number. 48 crore smartphones and 95 crore mobile phones. I think it's a huge, huge penetration. Okay? And the rate at which smartphones are increasing is just a question of 1 year or 2 year or 3 years, when this will be much bigger than the other kind of phones. Bank account, we have already seen. There's so much of enrollment of bank account, Jandhan, and all that. So effectively, these are the three things. Now, what is the idea of this? Identity, access mechanism, which is mobile, and subsidy handling mechanism, which is bank account. These three things together actually make a full stack of governance. And I'll talk about this a little bit later. Then, easy access to common service centers. This is probably not applicable much to this population, but there are common service centers which have been created by the government in every small town and every small village. These are basically service provisioning units. Common service center is actually a section 25 company or chapter 8 company, which basically provides these services on a charge basis. So if you need a caste certificate, you go to that particular place and give you a caste certificate. If you need income tax return certificate, you go to that particular place, they'll give you income tax return certificate. You want to apply for PAN card, you go to that place and apply for PAN card. And many of these things can be actually done at common service center if you don't have mobile phone, if you don't have internet access and these kind of things. The next item is shareable private space on a public cloud. Now this, many of you probably would have heard Digital Locker, DigiLocker, where you can actually put your diplomas, degrees and all that. From last year onward, all CBSE 10th and class 12th certificates as well as mark sheets are given on DigiLocker. Okay? DigiLocker is actually indexed by your Aadhaar number. So you provide your Aadhaar number, you can actually dump your own degree, diploma, certificates, copies of that into that, And when you apply for a job or something, just give a QR code or a URL for that. Okay? And it can be verified. Safe and secure cyberspace. Now, if more and more utilities and more and more dependence is going to be on cyberspace has to be safe. And this is the next. So these are the vision of infrastructure. Infrastructure vision. The governance and services means the following thing. Seamlessly integrated across department and jurisdiction. Those who have actually been in the government would know how difficult it is to actually get information from one department to another department. It is not because they don't want to share it. It's just because they don't know how to share it. What could be the implications of this? And therefore, the safest thing is not to share it. Okay? This is a big problem. Seamlessly integrated across department and jurisdiction sounds very easy, but from a vision viewpoint, it is a big challenge. Now, today it is possible, for example, for one to apply for passport. Okay? And when you apply for passport, it actually carries a lot of data. It carries your demographic data. It carries your education details. It carries various affidavits. It carries your date of birth certificate. It carries your income tax proof. You know, variety of other things, right? All of these things come from different departments. Some from state government, some from municipal government, some from central government, some from different departments of the government. And this is a big challenge. Some from non-governmental department. Now, it is possible to apply for passport online. This itself is a remarkable thing. On the front end, it doesn't look like that. But on the back end, there's so many technologies, so many things people actually talk about. Because sharing of such data is a challenging thing. Right? I mean, it is very, very different than, for example, taking somebody's notes and copying it. Even though it's the information is the same. So the backend side is a huge, huge challenge. Different protocols, different things, different ways of accessing. All kind of things. But in order to be able to do this and provide this service to a citizen as a single platform, it's a big, huge challenge and big, huge plus. So services available in real time and integrated manner from online and mobile platform. So this particular second bullet item, the services available in real time and online is also a mechanism which we are using for e-sign. So again, a big bullet item. All citizen entitlements should be available on cloud. You know, there's a huge preference which happens in the system because one doesn't know whether he's entitled or not entitled. Right? A scholarship. We have seen so many scholarship scams. Public distribution system, ration cards. We are seeing so much of scam in the country. Largely because information is not available. If information is not available, you know, people can play around with that, right? And if people can play around with that, the middleman can play around much more. So there is a huge thing that actually happens here. If this information available on the cloud and integrated with service sector services, then this fulfills both of them. In fact, LPG is one big example where LPG subsidy, which was being given, the subsidy bill was very, very high. It was higher than there was an estimate that was done by the Ministry of Petroleum, and the total subsidy that was given was more than the total gas connections multiplied by 450 rupees, which is what government was saying at that time is a subsidy. The bill flows are more than that. So how can it be? Total number of houses as per the census records multiplied by 450, what one would imagine is the maximum subsidy, because many people don't even have gas connections. But this would be the upper limit. But the subsidy was higher than that. So obviously there was a huge preference. Okay? In fact, a very interesting exercise that was done, all of you probably would be aware of that, when we actually identified how many duplicate gas connections are there, right? And this exercise was actually done using supercomputers of CDAP, where we actually used to run this, and every time you give out, you know, this information, the Ministry of Petroleum will give out saying in Ghaziabad, these many duplicate connections, in UP, these many duplicate connections, in Delhi, these many duplicate connections, all that. This was all coming from our analytics, and it was across services, whether it was Indian or Bharat Gas or Hindustan Petroleum or whatever. It was all across services, across vendors, and it was actually being done. Duplicate analysis is actually a very, very difficult scenario because people actually write names differently. Names change with time. R Muna, Rajat Muna. Muna R. Right? And on top of it, there can be spelling mistakes. My name is typically misspelled as M-O-N-A if I come in north, and if I come in the south, something else. If I go in Rajasthan, something else. I have never found somebody spelling my name correctly except me and my family members and my friends. So, it's basically, the problem is that in that scenario, if you find duplicate, is a big, big challenge. And this used to be a supercomputing problem. This algorithm was given by somebody else. We did not write this algorithm. But a similar thing that we did for election commission, we converted it to non-supercomputing problem, constant time problem. I will not talk about that, but you can actually do electoral roll search and all that, which actually comes out almost like a jiffy. You know, just type in your name and search, it'll come out and say these many names come. Exact or inexact, all over the country. And this is huge data. So, I will not talk about that, but this particular thing was done. So, services were digitally transformed for improving ease of doing business. Now, this is another big challenge internationally if you look at. In India, we say governance is poor. There are too many queues, too many permissions and all that permits that one needs to get. And in general, ease of doing business is very, very low. This was the idea that can we actually make services digitally transformed so that ease of doing business can be higher. And this is one thing that we are going to use for eSign. Okay. Making financial transactions electronic and cashless. I think you are already seeing this. Demonetization actually accelerated that. Leveraging geographical information system GIS for decision making and doing the development. Again, I will not get into that because there are different things. Okay. Digital empowerment basically means a very interesting thing. In the country, let's define something called as one can do it in English. So do it in English is, there are people who can understand English, people who can speak English, people who can read English, people who can write English. And in addition to that, people who can actually make out a little bit here and there, enough for doing the website navigation. So this is like people who can do it in English. That population in India is close to about 10-12% as per the estimate. Which basically means assuming 15% of the population of kids who may not need these services online, you are actually saying something close to about 70% of the population does not have access to digital media because if it is only in English. Right? Now that's a huge number. Okay? So here we are talking of creating a universal digital literacy and creating universally accessible digital resources. These two things, and of course, document certificates to be available on cloud. We already talked about this, diplomas, availability of digital resources in Indian languages. These are the basic ideas to actually say, make things available to everybody. And there's a lot of work which is happening. Collaborative digital platform for participative governance, private-public partnership, right, where on the same platform, digital platform, companies, industries, individuals, and governments can come together and provide the governance. And portability of all entitlement through cloud. Again, none of these things are actually very relevant for e-sign, but I thought I'll talk about this. So, Digital India is actually structured around 9 pillars. And that's what they call 9 pillars of Digital India. Broadband highway to provide broadband connectivity, universal access to phones, e-governance, public internet access program, we are seeing this, public Wi-Fi and all that which are talking about, e-Kranti, which is electronic delivery of services, electronic manufacturing, information for everybody, information technology for jobs, and some early harvest program. We come under early harvest program. Okay. Now this is about Digital India. Now let me talk about what is one particular aspect of this, which is Aadhaar identity. And let me talk about a little bit on Aadhaar identity, and then after that I'll move on to a little more technical thing. So what happens in Aadhaar case? Person's demographic details, name, age, date of birth, father's name, you know, address, and all that is captured. This is the identity. Along with this, biometric information, fingerprint and iris. These informations are actually collected at the time of registration. And when it is collected, as soon as it is collected, an Aadhaar number is allocated. Now, it goes through a match in the entire database of 112 crore people to find out if there is a duplicate or not. And if it finds that there is a demographic duplicate, then the number is not given. The moment it finds that there is a demographic duplicate, this entry is not processed further. But if there is, or rather it's not processed further, it is delayed. It is delayed for, because there can be two people with the same name, same father's name. Right? So it is delayed for processing. However, if this don't demographic thing, then the Aadhaar number is stored to the person. However, this Aadhaar number is still not a confirmed number. Right? Now let me explain you what it is mean. It still goes through another cycle of figuring out whether there is a fictitious identity available with the same person, for the same person or not. Sometime it registered as Rajat Puna, sometime registered as Anil Agarwal. Right? So it has to be looked at. And that process, assuming that this doesn't happen, because at the time of registration, somebody looks at your ID, somebody looks at your address proof and all that, assuming it doesn't happen, largely your ID is the ID, Aadhaar ID. But then it actually goes through in the background for about a month long program of biometric check. Okay? And if biometric duplicates are detected, then your Aadhaar number is withdrawn. Otherwise, your Aadhaar number remains the same. Okay? So this is the way it is done. So effectively, you can get your Aadhaar number if you enroll today. You can get it in just 2 days. 2 days time, you can actually get that. A lot of people actually have been doing that. And in about a month, month and a half time, you will know whether this Aadhaar number is yours or not. In the sense, if it is withdrawn or not, based on the duplicate of biometrics. Deduplication checks ensure that person is not issued two identities effectively. And you have to verify identity. Now, this is the second part. So this is identity which is actually recorded. This is the database of all the identities. And this Aadhaar is not a definition of citizenship, it is a definition of residential status. It is actually ID for residence. In fact, it can be given to foreigners also if they are in India. It can be given to NRIs also if they come to India and get it registered. Okay? So it is a residential proof. It's a proof of residence. Now, this can be verified online. Now, how is this verified online is the following. So, it has fingerprint, it has iris pattern, and it has biometric. Now, if I want to get my ID verified, I put my fingerprint or and put my Aadhaar number. Two things are captured and sent to Aadhaar to verify. And Aadhaar comes back and says yes or no. Yes, this ID belongs to this person, or it does not belong to that person. Aadhaar ID is a useless ID as a printed card. The only meaningful thing is Aadhaar number only when it is verified and authenticated online. Otherwise, it's a useless ID because you can print it. There's no visual security at all. You can print any number of them. Okay, you can print fake one if you want. Right? The Aadhaar significance is the ID which can be verified online. There is nothing else. Okay? Now, this is what Aadhaar does. So, Aadhaar verifies, returns true or false status. Now, this is a very, very unique proposition in the world. Nowhere in the world such kind of thing exists. There have been large identity programs. For example, US runs Social Security ID. Right? But but it's not online verified. A lot of countries have been doing that. Korea runs, you know, Estonia runs. A lot of people actually have an ID program. But then, it is this ID, which is a very unique proposition, which is online verifiable. Doesn't exist anywhere except in Estonia, which is a very, very small country. Now, this coupled with mobile phone will suddenly provide a very, very big thing. Okay? So, this verification identity can be done with mobile phone as well. So, I'll talk about that. Now, the second technology of Aadhaar is Aadhaar-based KYC, Know Your Customer, which is what we call as eKYC. If I can verify a person's identity, then I can even provide the identity information. Provided the person says his identity can be shared. So let's say Reliance Jio, right? Many of you must have gotten the SIMs, right? How did you get the SIM? You got the SIM by going to the counter, putting your fingerprint on his mobile. You know, there's a small unit which is attached to the mobile, fingerprint sensor. You put your fingerprint there, and he gives you activated SIM right there and there itself. You give Aadhaar number and the fingerprint. Why? Because Reliance actually was doing Aadhaar-based authentication. Aadhaar-based for issuance of mobile phone, KYC is a norm, is a mandatory requirement. Right? If it's a mandatory requirement, KYC requires a verification of identity. Right? So you give address proof, you give ID proof, somebody will give you the SIM, but SIM will not get activated till it is verified. There will be a person who will probably come and verify and so on. Right? With Aadhaar, it is actually possible to do online verification, and therefore it was possible to do it. Right? At that instant, you could get that. Okay? And this is one example. In fact, a lot of, now today, almost every service provider is doing that. You want to buy a SIM, you go and get that SIM straight away with verification. So this eKYC is basically a mechanism where upon the consent which is given by the ID holder, ID information, demographic information can be provided. Verified demographic information can be provided. Okay. Now, how do you authenticate a person? You authenticate a person by multiple mechanisms. It can be based on OTP. So, you know, you go and say, I want to verify using OTP. Aadhaar will send you an OTP which you have to type in onto the machine of Reliance Jio, saying this is the OTP that I got. Reliance Jio will not be able to use that OTP in any way. It takes your Aadhaar number and sends this OTP straight to Aadhaar saying verify. And Aadhaar says yes, verified, and this is the ID. Or it could be fingerprint based. You give the Aadhaar number plus fingerprint together and it goes into a single pass. Or iris scan. These are the three ways using which ID can be verified. Yeah. That is not doing authentication. That is doing enrollment. Yeah, so it is 1-to-1 match. So basically, what it basically means is with your index with your Aadhaar number, you have 10 fingerprints and iris, right? You provide one of these fingerprint and Aadhaar number. This as a packet goes to Aadhaar. And since it is indexed with your Aadhaar number, it actually can verify only against those 10 fingers. Okay, and it will say yes or no. So it is actually not 1-to-1 in the true sense, but it is more like 1-to-10, okay, 1-to-N in that sense, but it is, when you say N is the person, then it is 1-to-1, right, it is one person's information verified against one person.
Basically, Aadhaar number is just the index.
Aadhaar number is just the index, okay. During enrollment, you don't have Aadhaar number. During enrollment for deduplication, it takes your fingerprint, looks at all the fingerprints, okay, of 112 crore and says it is okay or not okay. That process is almost like a month long process. Yeah.
Sharing the Aadhaar biometrics with private company Reliance, doesn't it make your
there is no sharing. Aadhaar does not share biometric with anybody. Aadhaar can only tell you whether you are the genuine person or not. Biometric is not shared, only demographic information is shared. That is different from Aadhaar fingerprint. Okay? So that's why the user consent is needed, and when Reliance is doing that, Reliance just can't do it just like that. They need to sign up with Aadhaar saying they will not store this fingerprint anywhere. In fact, recently there have been certain kind of notices which were sent out to various service providers saying that they might be storing the fingerprint. But that is only for services. In fact, we regularly store fingerprint. Our attendance system in CDAC is based on Aadhaar. Okay? At the time of enrollment, we verify with Aadhaar and store that fingerprint into the card. And subsequently, it is only verified with the stored fingerprint. But that storage is not in my database. That is in the card. So since I am using this Aadhaar service, I cannot store any of the private information with me. I can take private information, pass it on to the person, there is no problem.
I heard that these hackers which these using people are using, these are also provided by Aadhaar.
No, they are not provided by Aadhaar, they are certified by Aadhaar.
They may encrypt all this information as soon as...
No, there is no encryption. It is only certified by Aadhaar, there is no encryption. There is no encryption. Encryption is only for the communication channel. Okay. Now, let me talk of... So, I have talked about eKYC, I have talked about Aadhaar. Now, let me talk about eSign. And in order to understand eSign, we need to understand a little bit about asymmetric key cryptography. Okay. So, asymmetric key cryptography basically means the following. There are two people, sender and receiver. Okay. Sender wants to send something to the receiver. Okay. In order to do that, there must be a key pair. Asymmetric key basically works on key pair. So there are two keys, private key and public key. The private key, which is denoted by PR, remains with the receiver. And public key is public, is known to the world. So it is known to the sender, it is known to everybody. Somehow. We'll talk about it little later how. Okay? But somehow it is known to everybody. Okay? And then when this guy wants to send something, plain text P, he wants to send it to the receiver, he encrypts and generates a ciphertext called C. In order to encrypt this, the only thing that he requires is the public key of the receiver, which is known publicly. Okay? And on this side, if C is available, he can get P by decrypting. And in order to decrypt, he requires private key, and public key is required for encryption. Now, you cannot decrypt using private key. You cannot encrypt using private key, and you cannot decrypt using public key. Which means, using this C, this guy cannot decrypt, and nobody else can decrypt. And using this C, this guy cannot get the P using his own public key. In fact, this doesn't make sense. I mean, if he has a private key, he has a public key as well. Right? Okay. This is an insecure communication channel, let's say internet, onto which people would be actually observing this communication and would try to figure out what the plain text is or what the private key is. These are the two secrets, right? So he will try to, mostly try to find P prime, which is a simpler problem, but might want to even try and decipher private key as well, which is even more difficult. Okay? And the security of this system depends on how difficult it is to get P prime and PR prime. Right? This is the basic thing. There are various asymmetric key based functions or operations, crypto operations. Encryption and decryption I talked about. Given a message, encryptor uses the public key of intended recipient to encrypt and generate ciphertext C. Decryption is the reverse. Given a ciphertext, the decryptor can use the private key to get the original message. There are two more things called signature and signature verification. Signature basically means there is a signer, signer can compute the hash of a message or a document and use its private key to generate signature on this hash. Okay? So only signer can do that. Private key is with the signer. And sign verification is the other side, where verifier can use the document, compute the hash, and this signature which has been done, which is available. So whether you require the document and the signature, verify the signature using public key of the signer. Mistake here. So verify the signature using public key of the signer. Okay? So using public key of the signer, you can actually get this hash H, and using document you can get the hash again H and verify whether these two are equal or not. Apart from these two, there is one more operation called signature with message recovery. This is for those operations which are very small operations, very small messages. This is primarily used for sending keys and all that. If your message is very small, you actually don't have to compute the hash. Just take this message M itself and use the private key. On the other side, it can be just recovered using the public key. So these are the five primitives. RSA is a public key crypto system which typically uses modular exponents, modular exponentiation, which is a computationally, discrete log, which is a reverse of modular exponentiation, is a tough problem to solve. Okay? So modular exponentiation make it computationally infeasible to recover message without key, provided, and of course there are a lot of ifs here, provided the message is carefully crafted and key is carefully selected. These two things are very important. You should not use a key which is easy to decode, and you should not use a message, like suppose the message is 1, a number 1, all zeros followed by 1, right? 1 to the power n will remain 1 only. Whatever modulus you do, it will remain 1. So therefore message 1 cannot be encrypted using this. So message has to be carefully crafted and keys have to be carefully selected. Right? This is typically defined in what is known as Public Key Crypto System PKCS standards. There are PKCS multiple standards called PKCS 1 to 15. PKCS 1 has two versions, 1.5 and 2.1, which define RSA encryption standard. Okay, and 2.1 defines slightly more advanced version of that. But this effectively say how you should do encryption, how should you do decryption, how should you do signature, how should you do verification, and how should you do with message recovery. Okay, I think I will probably skip this except telling you what is public key. Public key has actually two parameters, one is known as modulus, the second one is known as public exponent. Public, both of these are public information, so these are two integers. Okay. In private key, we have many more things, modulus and public exponent, and therefore this is private public key also. But in addition to that, there is a private exponent, which is secret. There are factors of n, which are prime 1 and prime 2, called p and q. The factored information is available here, and various exponents, various things which are available, which are going to simplify the computation to decrypt. Okay? Effectively, this is the confidential information. The rest of it can be derived out of this and n. Okay? But if these are available, then your computation becomes more, better quickly to do that computation, quickly to decrypt. Okay. Now, what is digital signature? So, for a document, compute this hash called H. Now, use the private key. Now, I don't want to use this terminology called encrypt and decrypt, but those were the public crypto system operations. In case of RSA, in cipher will basically mean modular exponentiation. Okay? But in different contexts, in different public crypto system, it will mean different things. So, it is in cipher. Use private key to encipher this H, and what comes out is digital signature. To verify H, you just decipher whatever is digital signature using public key. So you just change the role of public key and private key from encryption and email. Document hash can be computed using H prime, right? So you have a document, hash algorithms are known. So compute H prime. If H and H prime match, that means document is not modified and it is signed by so and so person. Important thing here is public key, right? And whose public key? How do you know that this public key is my public key, right? And that is the important part, and digital signature is actually largely dependent on this. It is actually known using as digital certificates. In this context, for signature, we also call it as digital signature certificates or DSCs. This is important. Now, what is this? So, if the problem is public key genuine? When a party wants to communicate or authenticate, it needs public key of the other party. Question is, how do I first of all get the public key in a secure manner, in a general manner? It could be it is available to me a priori, or it could be that I somehow get it and trust it. Okay? And this is certificate and certification authority that comes in. Now, let me explain what is the certification. So certification authority is an authority to whom everybody trusts. Both two sides, sender and receiver. For example, let's say IIIT. Now, IIIT is a registration authority. Every student actually is certified using IIIT. Now, everybody trusts IIIT's key. Right? So, IIIT keys is available, somehow everybody gets it. Okay? Now, if you know public key of IIIT, right? Then using the public key of IIIT, I can get somebody's certificate, extract the first verify the certificate and extract the public key. Verification of that will be done using IIIT public key. So this is an authority to whom everybody trusts in that domain. Okay? Now what CA does is CA signs the public key using his own private key. So effectively that signed public key is now available. Right? So you verify using CA's public key, and then since it is verified, you extract the public key of the entity of the person and use that. Is this clear to everybody? Am I not losing anybody? Right? This is a very complicated thing. Is everybody with me? Okay. I think this is probably the most complicated thing that I was planning to cover, but. I think I'll skip this. This is a standard call X509 certificate, but I'll just give you more details on this, what it contains. Okay? So it contains the following things. A certificate typically contains the following things. Serial number. You know, every certification authority is required to give a serial number. Serial number 1 certificate, serial number 1 certificate, serial number 2 certificate, serial number 3. Maintain a register of serial numbers and to whom it has been issued. Okay? It's a mandatory requirement. So therefore, this is a serial number. So now tomorrow, for example, if you want to do an audit, or you suddenly get a certificate, suddenly get somebody's public key, we can go back to the certifying authority and say, tell me whom did you issue this certificate number 5103? You know, is it correct or not? So it is manually verifiable also. Then, which algorithm is used to compute the certificate, compute the digital signatures by the CA? Who is the issuer? Who is the certifying authority? His name. Okay? Validity. This certificate is valid between this date to this date. The student certificate is valid the day he is registered to the day he is expected to graduate. Right? Subject. Subject basically says the person to whom the certificate is issued, his name. And these names are X500 names, which are fully qualified names. It will have many attributes. What is common name, what is organization, what is your designation, what is your location, what is your address, what is your telephone number. All of this information will be there in this. Okay? So it is a standardized format. Then public key information, which includes what algorithm is used, what operations you can perform, and what is the actual public key. And then certificate signature algorithm and certificate signature. All of this together is then issued as a certificate. So at the recipient side, you will verify the signatures using this signature algorithm. Look at all these details, whether this is valid or not, and extract the public key and perform the audit. Right? If it is allowed. Okay. So why is digital signature important? Digital signature is important because it's an important tool for online governance. Digital signature provides for non-repudiation. Non-repudiation basically means that after this signature is done by the signer, signer cannot say I did not sign it. It is provable that he signed it. Okay? So digital signatures provide for non-repudiation. Information Technology Act, IT Act provides for legal validity for digital signatures. In the court of law, you can give a PDF file saying this is signed by so and so person and therefore it is a valid proof of a document. So it is a valid legal validity provided the certifying authority has issued a certificate to the signer for his public key after carrying out necessary KYC. It's an important thing that certifying authority must have done KYC. Right? The certifying authority operations are largely manual because KYC requires verification. So initially when you issue a certificate, you apply and somebody will come and do a KYC verification and after that the certificate will be given to you in USB token, which you can use. EKYC actually solves this problem. It can be online. And therefore, you can see where I'm coming from. Right? So it can actually provide digital signatures online. So Aadhaar EKYC renders this manual verification redundant and therefore a CA can actually now issue the certificate and not just the certificate, even generate the signatures for you. Okay? So this is what I want to talk about. You know, very quickly, what is e-Hastaksha, which is an online digital signature. I already talked about this. So this is the basic architecture. There is a web interface. All of these are website, web services. There is a web interface through which a person will actually submit his document, income tax return, you know, application for PAN, application of passport, all that kind of things. This is a web service. Okay. Through this web service, when one puts it and says sign, it actually comes to this e-sign interface. With the Aadhaar number, it sends it out to UIDAI saying verify. UIDAI will generate an OTP, send it back to the person. Onto the same web interface, he will put his OTP as well. When OTP and number is available, Aadhaar number is available, two things are sent back to UIDAI along with the consent. And UIDAI will now give me the biometric information after authentication of that. It will give me the demographic information of the person through which I can do eKYC. If I can do eKYC, I can now generate a key pair, generate a certificate, sign the document and pass it on. This is in a nutshell what it is. Document, step 1, step 2, you come to the service provider, step 3 goes to the authentication mechanism to UIDAI. Wow. Certificate is issued, key pair is generated, signature is computed and returned back to the person who puts it into the document. I think I have more details, but you know, specific details, but we can actually skip this and get on to. So this is the basic thing. First phase, get the OTP. Second phase, now use the OTP, go to UIDAI, verify, go to certifying authority, all this, and then get the signature. And it entire thing takes about 1 to 1.5 seconds for doing a transaction. Okay, there are several things that we have done on based on this. E-sign, you know, legal documents. There is a legal company, legal contracts can be signed. So and so person will upload the document and then use e-sign button and it will actually sign. E-sign button will pop up a screen where you will give the UIDAI, I mean Aadhaar number and the OTP and so on and so forth. Okay. Home loans. Several banks have been actually doing this instant verification. Once you upload your document, instant loan approval for homes. Typically, this process requires about 4 or 5 days. Right? It can be done now online. Okay. This is the PAN card application. Right? So you can actually apply and then go put out all the details and say sign, and the PAN card will be generated immediately and given to you online. So, I mean, I have already talked about many applications. Very recently, we have been doing this with GST. Something close to about 20,000 signatures a day are being done today, and the number is going to go to something like about 200,000 once GST is rolled out. So it's a huge thing, huge potential. We are also linking it up with DigiLocker so that tomorrow you can put your documents within DigiLocker interface in the e-sign. We did it for CBSE, where CBSE actually did a bulk signing for all the digital signature certificates and put it onto the digital. So I think with this, I come to an end, and I will be willing to take a few questions if time permits. Yes.
E-Locker, how do they verify the authentication of that certificate?
They don't verify. Today, it is a notification which has been issued by the government saying that you can attest your own certificate and keep. Self-attestation is possible. So you take your certificate, scan it, sign it and store it in the digital locker.
So you do an e-signature on that particular...
Yeah, absolutely. Somebody signs using e-sign, is it verified using OTP? Verification is part of authentication of the person, right? So Aadhaar does that. Aadhaar will send you an OTP and you will give that OTP to me and I'll send it to Aadhaar for you. Okay? Or it will be by fingerprint. In the form of PFX files or the USB tokens, they existed since ages, right? But in order to get this, you need to first get the digital signature certificate, and that process is a long process. We are eliminating that process so that it can be instant signature.